If you go to the factors affecting the solubility, that is similar structural aspects in molecules, in polar molecules, let me say polar molecules, in polar molecules, example we can take, that is ethyl alcohol and water, and water both have almost similar structure, both of them are polar in nature, both of them are polar molecules, and both of them have the similar kind of structures. If you take the, I mean, if in fact you can take even the ethyl alcohol also, it's a derivative of water. So if you take, if you take the structure of oxygen, I mean if you take the structure of water, sorry, it contains two lone pairs, and wherein which it contains two hydrogens and one oxygen. If you go for ethyl alcohol also, it has the same kind of structure. Of course, it contains two lone pairs, it has one hydrogen and it contains one ethyl group. So you're finding that it contains one ethyl group with the presence of two lone pairs. Because of the electronegative difference, you can see that there's a kind of polarity existing between the oxygen atom and the hydrogen in the case of ethyl alcohol, as well as because of the electronegative difference in the oxygen and hydrogen also, there exists certain polarity. So you can find that both the ethyl alcohol and water, because of the similar structural aspects, both of them, they are soluble against each other. That's because they have the same strength of intermolecular forces in the form of hydrogen bonding. I mean to say, if you take the miscibility, in other words, miscibility, again we can speak in terms of solubility. Miscibility is equal in both, that is ethyl alcohol and water, because of the presence of, that is hydrogen bonding, because of the hydrogen bonding. Next is, if you go to the second factor, similar molecular structural environment. This is applicable for, that is non-polar covalent molecules. Example, we can take, that is, benzene. Can take benzene and that is toluene. Toluene is methyl benzene. So here, if you take the benzene, this is benzene and this is toluene. So you have the benzene ring in benzene molecule, in the aromatic hydrocarbon, you find benzene ring, and in toluene also you have benzene ring. So if they have similar, that is molecular environment, so therefore both of them, they are miscible with each other. That means the solubility is to a maximum extent between the benzene and toluene. Now then comes the third factor, that is dielectric constant, which is given by D. So here, when you speak about the dielectric constant, all the molecules, I can put it in this way, molecules with the greater dielectric constant, greater is the solubility. For example, if I take water has a dielectric constant almost equal to 82.0, then similarly, if you take molecules with lesser dielectric constant will have lesser solubility. For example, if you are going to take methanol, the dielectric constant for methanol is just 3.2. and for that is acetone. If you go for acetone, if you're going for acetone, that is dielectric constant is just 33.5 for acetone. That means lesser is the dielectric constant, lesser is the solubility. So that means in this aspect, this dielectric constant plays a very important role in solubility of the given solute in a given solvent. So here, if you take the dielectric constant, let me put it in this way, that is, if I can take that U is directly proportional to F, F is directly proportional to Q1 into Q2 divided by R square into 1 by D. So here U stands for lattice energy in, that is, crystalline solids. Then F is the of repulsive forces maybe between ions or molecules can be polar or non-polar, and Q1, comma Q2 are the magnitude of charges in ions of polar molecules. And similarly, R is the distance of separation, that is radial distance between distance of separation between two ions, oppositely charged ions. And D is the dielectric constant. So here I can say, that is, here one more important point what you have to understand is, you should know what is the meaning of dissolution. Dissolution is a term that is amount of solid dissolved in a given solvent, or the amount of solid in the form of solute which is able to dissolve in a given amount of solvent, we call it as dissolution. That means this dissolution is a term which we are going to get. This dissolution term, that means solubility, you are speaking about the solubility in terms of solid, in terms of liquid. When you are speaking about solubility of solid in terms of liquid, we come across this word dissolution. Then if you go for crystallization is the amount of solute molecules separating from solvent in solution is crystallization. So that means at equilibrium in terms of solubility of solid in liquid, at equilibrium you find that a stage is going to establish where rate of dissolution is in equilibrium with the rate of crystallization. So this is one point which you have to keep it in mind. So but what is happening here is, what we have to understand here is, that is one of the most important distinguishing feature which we have to understand is, when rate of solvation is greater than rate of crystallization, then solubility increases. Upward arrow indicates that it is increasing. This is because dielectric constant increases, lattice energy decreases. When dielectric constant increases, lattice energy decreases, that is, you are finding that the ions break through and pass into solution. So suppose, for example, let me give you some examples. If I give you some examples, you can understand what is happening in all these cases. So once again, I am going to just brief up everything here. U is the lattice energy. Lattice energy is directly proportional to attractive forces or repulsive forces between the two oppositely charged ions or the polar molecules or non-polar molecules. Q1 and Q2 are the charges operating between the two oppositely charged ions, and R is the radius distance of separation between the two oppositely charged ions in the aqueous solution, and D is the dielectric constant. So what we are noticing here is, from this mathematical expression, we have come across that if you are particularly speaking solubility in terms of solid in liquid, that means if you are dissolving some known quantity of solid in a given quantity of liquid as a solvent at a given specific temperature or a specified temperature, then you find that the dissolution and the crystallization process takes place back to back in that given container. Under such circumstances, we understand the dissolution process as the amount of solid in the form of solute that is going to be dissolved in a given amount of solvent is dissolution. And at the same time, if the solute molecules in the given container, suppose if you are taking a container and if you are taking some amount of solvent is usually water, and say you are adding sodium nitrite. If you are adding sodium nitrite as a salt, this salt will try to dissolve uniformly in this solvent, and the process of dissolution continues. But at the same time, if the same solute particles try to collide against each other, if there is a collision against each other, then this collision leads to separation. Then once the separation of the solute particles begins, then that results in the form of crystallization. The crystallization, we can call it as the amount of solute molecules separating from the given solvent due to the collision with the adjacent solute particles. If the solute particles start colliding with the adjacent solute particles, then they start separating. Once the separation starts, then that will ultimately result in the crystallization. Then once the crystallization and the dissolution, both of them, is taking place in the given aqueous solution, then that means we have to understand that according to the Lee-Chatelier's principle, at equilibrium, rate of dissolution is equal to rate of crystallization. From this observation, we should also understand that from this mathematical expression and from this observation of rate of dissolution and rate of crystallization, we should also understand that rate of solvation is definitely, if the rate of solvation is greater than the rate of crystallization, it also means that the solubility definitely increases under such conditions. The solubility is increasing means, it means that for that given solvent, when a solute is dissolved in that solvent contains more dielectric constant, that means the dielectric constant value is higher for the given solvent. If dielectric constant is more, lattice energy is less. When lattice energy is less, the lattice breaks in the crystalline solid, ions are formed. These ions break through and they become mobile ions, and these ions, they pass into the solutions, and therefore the ionic mobility also increases. So in this way, we can understand very clearly what is exactly happening in the case of solubility of solids in liquids. Of course, when you are speaking about the solubility of solids in liquids, we should also speak about the effect of temperature. When you go for effect of temperature, what kind of influence the temperature is making on the solubility of solids in liquids, that also we are going to study. So if you go to the continuation of the discussion, that is effect of temperature, effect of temperature in solubility of solids in liquids. temperature has lot of influence. So here actually the solubility, it's like this solute plus solvent is in equilibrium with the formation of solution. Here solute is a solid, and solvent is a liquid. So here what is happening is the extent of when a solid is able to dissolute, it goes like this. When a solid is able to dissolute in a liquid, the dissolution depends whether the heat, this dissolute of the solid in liquid again depends upon that is energy absorbed, or energy released. Energy absorbed or energy released. If energy is absorbed, then it is this, then the salts are, then when a solid is dissolved in liquid, it's going to become a solution. It's going to become a salt solution. So that means this salt solution, now because when the energy is absorbed, it becomes endothermic salts. So in terms of thermodynamic function, if you apply the enthalpy function, enthalpy of the mixing, enthalpy change for all endothermic salts, the enthalpy change is greater than zero, then you find that because the enthalpy change is greater than zero, it means that the temperature is decreasing. When the temperature decreases, the solubility increases. When the energy is absorbed, temperature decreases. T for temperature, is decreasing, solubility, is increasing. Example you can take, number of examples you can take, sodium nitrite, potassium nitrate, then sodium chloride, all these are endothermic salts. Then if you go for exothermic salts, energy release means it is exothermic salt. If it is an exothermic salt, then you find that the enthalpy change, the thermodynamic function for the enthalpy change, the change in the enthalpy is less than zero. If it is less than zero, that means the sign convention is taken as negative. If it is less than zero, then that means here the temperature is increasing. The temperature is increasing, solubility, is decreasing. The best example for exothermic salts you can take, that is sodium carbonate is an example of exothermic salt. Calcium carbonate is an exothermic salt. Ammonium chloride is an exothermic salt, and so on. These are all the examples of exothermic salts. So that means the temperature is showing lot of influence on the solubility of solids in liquids. And because the pressure, does not have any effect on the solubility of solids in liquids, because the solids are incompressible. So here one point what you can write is pressure has effect of pressure or pressure has no effect. Pressure has no influence. Pressure has no influence on solubility, of solids in liquids. The main reason is, because all solids are, they are incompressible. All solids are incompressible. So this is the solubility of solids in liquids. Now we'll go for the second category in the solubility. So the case one is completed. Go for the solubility of gas in liquids. So that is, now we'll go for solubility, fourth case, solubility of gases in liquids. So in this solubility of gas in liquids, yes, here what are the factors, operating? There are two important factors. One is pressure and the other one is temperature. T for temperature and P for pressure. One more important aspect is the solubility of gases in liquids. It's a special case of, Henry's law. It's a special case of Henry's law. What is the principle involved in the gases dissolving in liquids? Gases dissolving in liquids principle, like dissolves like is the principle involved in the solubility of gas in liquids. Take some examples. You can take carbon disulfide, readily dissolves in carbon tetrachloride or in benzene because both have similar molecular environment, both have the same kind of molecular interactions and both have the same kind of intermolecular forces. That's why the carbon disulfide as a solute can readily dissolve in the carbon tetrachloride as a solvent or benzene as a solvent. So here, if you go for Henry's law, that is gases dissolve in liquid solvents. Gases dissolve in liquid solvent, that means when they are dissolving in liquid solvents, that means the process of dissolution begins. Once the gases are able to dissolve completely in solvents, in during this dissolution process, gases, now they are existing in liquid state. As a result, what is happening when the gases starts dissolving in liquid as solvent? The gases exist as liquid state. Here you find that energy released. So enthalpy change is less than zero, or you can take enthalpy change is negative. So therefore, this comes under exothermic process. Hence, if it is exothermic process, then ultimately solubility of gas in liquids decreases with the increase in temperature. I am using increase in temperature because here the enthalpy change is negative. If it is negative, then it is enthalpy change is less than zero. When energy is released, we can say that the process is exothermic. That means, in other words, what I mean to say is that when the gases are dissolved in liquids, the process is going to become exothermic process. If it is exothermic process, energy is released. If the energy is released, then the solubility of gas in liquids decreases with rising temperature. So based on this observation, Henry who has given the empirical relationship from this observation. He says that is Henry's, according to the Henry's law, I can put it like this: according to Henry's law, solubility of a gas in given amount of solvent at constant temperature is proportional to partial pressure. In other words, when we use the word solubility, here solubility can be anything. Here when I say solubility of gas in liquids, solubility can be mass. The solubility can be mass, solubility can be partial pressure when the gas molecules are in the vapor phase. So if that is the case, that means mathematically we can put this Henry's law in the form of mathematical expression. Here solubility of gas means solubility means mass. So the mass of a gas at a given temperature, the given mass of gas at a given temperature, that is m, is directly proportional to, we are saying, partial pressure at constant temperature is directly proportional to partial pressure. So if you remove the proportionality, we are going to get a constant, m is equal to kh into p. This is the mathematical expression which is given by the Henry's constant, where here kh is the Henry's constant which depends on nature of gas, or you can just take the same expression as we can also take, because we are saying that the solubility is also depending on the partial pressure, or the same expression we can take it as partial pressure is directly proportional to mole fraction of the given component. Partial pressure of the gas in the vapor phase is directly proportional to its mole fraction of that particular component of the gas. So therefore, you can rewrite the expression as P is equal to KH into X. X is the mole fraction. Or we can also take one more expression, that is partial pressure, because mole fraction again depends upon the molality. So therefore, we can remodify the expression partial pressure of the gas in the vapor phase is also directly proportional to molality of the component of that gas. So P is equal to KH into molality. So we can use any one expression when we are doing numerical problems. We can use any one expression. We can use either mass of a given, the given mass of gas M is equal to Henry's constant into partial pressure, or partial pressure is equal to Henry's constant into mole fraction, or partial pressure is equal to Henry's constant into molality of the solution of that particular gas in the vapor phase. So if you want to plot a graph, take for example, you can take the mass of a gas. Here M stands for mass, this is for mass of a gas, mass of gas, and here M stands for molality. No need of getting confused, it is molality. So suppose if I want to plot a graph, plotting of graph, because we are trying to give an empirical relationship between solubility and partial pressure. Solubility here is mass of a gas in the vapor phase. So therefore, here if m is equal to KH into P, this is y is equal to mx plus c, I am equating it with 0. So y is equal to mx plus c. So because if you are this is equation of straight line, take the x coordinate and y coordinate. In the y coordinate, let us take mass of a gas, amount of the mass of gas expressed in grams, and in x coordinate let us take partial pressure, because intercept is 0. So we get a straight line passing through the origin, and here the slope is m is slope here, so the slope is nothing but Henry's constant. So this is the graph which is obtained for the Henry's constant when we are plotting the graph between the y coordinate, the mass of the gas, and in x coordinate we are taking the partial pressure of the given gases. So this is one of the important aspects which we have to keep it in mind, and all this comes under the Henry's law. So here, look into the two problems which we have noticed here. That is, you can see here in the first question, the problems are based on the Henry's constant concept. So here Henry's constant KH for the molality of the solubility of methane in a benzene ring, in the benzene solvent, because like dissolves like. You know very well that the Henry's law is based on the like dissolves like concept, wherein which they have similar molecular structures or similar molecular environments. Based on that, the given amount of solute can dissolve in a given amount of solvent at 298 Kelvin, that is at 25 degree centigrade, 4.27 to 10 to the power of 5 millimeters of mercury. So from the problem, it's very clear that Henry's constant is given to us, that is 4.27 into 10 to the power of 5 millimeters of mercury is given. Now, because he is asking pressure also, it is given. Pressure is 760 millimeters of mercury. It is constant and is asking us to calculate the solubility of the methane dissolving in benzene solvent. Methane as a solute dissolving in benzene as a solvent. So methane is a gas and benzene is a liquid. So gas in solid. So it is in accordance with the Henry's law. So therefore, let us apply directly. Straight away, let us try to apply the formula. That is, you can take directly partial pressure, because he is saying solubility, because he is asking us to calculate the solubility. Pressure is given, Henry's constant is given. The solubility can be expressed in terms of mole fraction, or it can be expressed in terms of molality. So directly I am going to take here partial pressure is equal to KH into, that is solubility in terms of mole fraction I am going to take. So this is going to be that is pressure is already given 760 millimeters. Then Henry's constant is given 4.27 into 10 to the power of 5 into mole fraction of that particular component. That is the solubility in terms of mole fraction. So x is equal to 760 divided by 4.27 into 10 to the power of 5. So this is going to become, that is 760 divided by 4.27, 4.27 into 10 to the power of minus 5. So this is going to become, that is 760 divided by 4.27 means approximately, I'm taking here nearly taking the precise value, approximate value 760 divided by 4 into 10 to the power of minus 5. I'm going to take, so this is 4 ones are 43 means 4 nines are 36. So 4 ones are 4, this is 3, 4 nines are 36. So 190 into 10 to the power of 5. So this is going to become, that is 19 into 10 to the power of minus 4. Minus 4, or you can take it as 1.9 into 10 to the power of minus 3 is the final answer in the form of mole fraction, that is in terms of solubility. When the partial pressure of the gas in the vapor phase and the Henry's constant is given as 4.27 into 10 to the power of 5 millimeters of mercury. So the final answer is 19 into 10 to the power of minus 4 or 1.9 into 10 to the power of minus 3 is the solubility. Because it is mole fraction, we can just ignore the units. Now look here, this is second problem. In the second numerical, what we are noticing here is, like the gas here is again ethane C2H6. Its weight is given, the weight is it has given, the weights of ethane are under two different cases, and at one particular stage of the partial pressure of ethane, for the partial pressure of ethane in one particular case, so for P1, let me take it like this. When the partial pressure is P1, let the number of moles of ethane be calculated as, that is 6.56 into 10 to the power of minus 3 divided by molecular weight of ethane is, that is 30, weight by gram molecular weight of ethane is 30, because we have two carbons, each carbon atomic weight 12, 12 2 is 24. And there are 6 hydrogens, each hydrogen atomic weight is 1, so 1 into 6 is 6, so total molecular weight of ethane is 30. So that means here, when the partial pressure of the ethane gas is considered as P1, the number of moles of ethane is taken as 30. But according to the problem, he has already given, in the first case, the partial pressure of ethane is already given, which is equal to 1 bar. So what we can consider is, that is nothing but, if that is, if I'll put it like this, if the partial pressure of the ethane gas is 1 bar, then the number of moles of ethane is equal to, that is 6.56 into 10 to the power of minus 3 divided by 30. This is first case. Now if the partial pressure is P2, this we don't know, then we can calculate the number of moles of ethane again, as that is weight of ethane, now it is 5.0, weight is 5.0 into 10 to the power of minus 2 grams, and the gram molecular weight is 30. But since mole fraction is nothing but the solubility, so mole fraction is proportional to number of moles of given component or to that of the total components. So we can slightly modify this problem and we can continue the solving of this problem. That is, we can take the relative ratio and we can calculate the partial pressure of the ethane gas when the number of moles of ethane gas is taken as 5.0 into 10 to the power of minus 2 divided by 30. If we equate P1 and P2 with respect to number of moles of ethane under two different cases, we can calculate the partial pressure of the ethane in the unknown case. So equating, we can get the answer. So continuation of this problem. So therefore, since partial pressure is equal to KH into mole fraction of that component, so therefore we can take P1 is equal to KH into X1 and P2 is equal to KH into X2. So here the Henry's constant is remaining constant. KH, Henry's constant, the value is same in both the cases. So on equating, if you just take the ratio, that is P1 by P2 is equal to KH into, that is X1, in the case of X1 I am substituting this value, now it is considered as X1 and this value is considered as X2, because the reason is mole fraction is depending upon the number of moles. So therefore I am going to take this value as, that is 6.56 into 10 to the power of minus 3 divided by 30, again divided by kh into, that is 5.0 into 10 to the power of minus 2 divided by 30. 30 gets cancelled, Henry's constant also gets cancelled. P1 value already we know, which is equal to 1 bar. So the final answer also we have to get as 1 bar only. So 1 by P2 is equal to, this is going to become, that is 6.56 divided by 5 into 10 to the power of minus 1. So this expression finally we can take this as P2 is equal to, that is 5 by 6.56 into 10 to the power of minus 1. So this is going to become 5000 divided by 656, which is equal to, so here after simplification of this value we are going to get 7.62 bar nearly after calculating. So the final answer is 7.62 bar is the final answer for this question. So here we go to the next part of the discussion, that is vapor pressure. When you go for vapor pressure, let us learn the concept like this, that is, if you go for vaporization is an open process. Vaporization is an open process. Then vapor pressure is a closed process. Then whether it is vaporization or whether it is vaporization or the vapor pressure, both they depends on the factors. What are the factors upon which this vapor pressure and the vaporization depends? What are the factors? Factors you can take, that is nature of solute, then effect of temperature, then surface area. Suppose for example, if you are taking vaporization, you take a container, if this is the container and if you are taking solvent molecules, these are the solvent molecules, you are finding that these are the solvent molecules, only one component is there, mind you, it can be, this is a solvent molecules which are pure. Once you are trying to increase the temperature, that means when you are rising the temperature, when you are trying to supply the energy, that is when you are increasing the temperature, that means indirectly all the molecules which are at the bulk of the liquid, bulk of the solvent, these molecules, they reach the surface and they escape into the atmosphere in the form of vapor molecules. These are vapor molecules. And this, mind you, this is an open process. That means what is the kind of simple meaning you can offer for the vaporization? Escape of gas molecules, because when we heat, all the liquid molecules, they reach the surface, they become vapors, they even change their physical state, they change from liquid state to vapor state. Once the molecules acquires the vapor state, these molecules, they try to quickly escape from the surface of the liquid and they become, vapor molecules, and they escape into the atmosphere. So escape of the gas molecules from surface of liquid. Surface of liquid is simply vaporization. And what is vapor pressure? The word itself has a meaning. That means, as already I told you, when you go for vapor pressure, it's a closed process. Already I told you, you take a container. In this container, you're trying to place a stopper. the stopper. This is a closed system wherein which we are finding that the solvent molecules, these are all solvent molecules, this is the surface area, surface of liquid, surface of liquid, the molecules, they are reaching the surface, all the molecules, they tend to move towards the surface, upper surface. So what is happening here, you are trying to increase the temperature, you are increasing the temperature, by increasing the temperature you are also indirectly, you are also increasing the kinetic energy of the molecules. The average kinetic energy of the molecules increases. When you increase the temperature of the liquid, automatically the average kinetic energy of the molecules also will increase, and all the molecules, they move from the bulk of the liquid, bulk of the solvent molecules, each individual molecule will reach the surface, and once they reach the surface, they start escaping from the surface and they go and start hitting the container here. As long as the temperature is increasing, you find that more and more number of molecules, they go and settle at the surface of the container. They settle at the surface of the stopper of the container. That means from this observation, what we are noticing is, if you want to define the vapor pressure, you can simply put it in simple terms, saying that the pressure exerted by the vapor molecules, pressure exerted by vapor molecules over the surface of liquid the pressure exerted by the vapor molecules over the surface of liquid when both the liquid and vapor molecules are in equilibrium with each other is simply called as vapor pressure. The pressure exerted by the vapor molecules over the surface of the liquid, when both liquid and the vapor molecules are in equilibrium with each other, we call it as vapor pressure of the pure solvent present in that component. But at the same time, when you are going on increasing the temperature continuously, all the molecules, they escape from the surface of the liquid of the container to the stopper, and they settle at the stopper. And in the meantime, you find that there is one particular point, the temperature at which vapor pressure of liquid becomes equal, vapor pressure of the liquid becomes equal to the atmospheric pressure, becomes equal to the atmospheric pressure. We call it as the boiling point of solution. We call that particular stage where the pressure of the liquid becomes equal to the atmospheric pressure, that means boiling point of the solution, can be understood as pressure of the liquid, if it becomes equal to the pressure of the atmosphere, then this results in the boiling point of the solution. This one particular point which you have to keep it in your mind. So here, if you take the vapor pressure, actually it's like this. Vapor pressure, its factors, when you take factors of the vapor pressure, it depends on the intermolecular forces. IMF represents the intermolecular forces. When you say intermolecular forces, strong intermolecular forces and weak intermolecular forces, weak intermolecular forces. Liquids which have all the liquids or the components which have stronger intermolecular forces, components which have stronger intermolecular forces, they are non-volatile and they have less vapor pressure. The components which have weak intermolecular forces, they are volatile and they have more vapor pressure. What did you understand by this? So here, that means when you go for vapor pressure, intermolecular forces, here also vapor pressure, intermolecular forces. If the intermolecular forces are weak, then the vapor molecules escape quickly, and that will result in vapor molecules escape quickly that will result in greater volatility and greater vapor pressure. On the other hand, if the intermolecular forces are strong, then vapor molecules do not escape so easily from the surface of the liquid. They are non-volatile. If they are non-volatile, then that will result in volatile means greater volatility, lesser volatility. Lesser volatility means they become non-volatile. Then under such case, it has low vapor pressure. When the vapor pressure is low, that is, you have to understand that when the vapor pressure is low, so here we can create one more point here, that is, intermolecular forces are inversely proportional to hydrogen bonding. Intermolecular forces are inversely proportional to hydrogen bonding. For example, intermolecular forces are directly proportional to hydrogen bonding. If they are directly proportional to hydrogen bonding, that means, for example, if you take water and if you take ethyl alcohol, virtually both water and ethyl alcohol, both of them, they have hydrogen bonding. Both have hydrogen bonding. Here relatively this is having weaker intermolecular forces. So I can say that it is greater volatile and it has greater vapor pressure. Water has stronger intermolecular forces relatively, then it is less volatile, then it also has less vapor pressure. So in other words, one more generalization what I could give you here is, that is, hydrogen bonding, all the molecules which are showing hydrogen bonding, any molecule which contains hydrogen bonding is directly proportional to, that is, stronger intermolecular forces results in greater non-volatility. Number of examples you can take, that is, water you can take, sulfuric acid you can take, acetic acid, all these are the best examples. And they are non-volatile. Hydrogen bonding is directly proportional to strong intermolecular forces and it is greater non-volatile in nature. On the other hand, if you go for the next case, one more generalization, if hydrogen bonding is absent, that is, weaker intermolecular forces is directly proportional to greater volatility, weaker intermolecular forces results in greater volatility. When greater is the volatility, that is lesser, greater volatility results in lesser hydrogen bonding. So this is one of the important aspects which we have to keep it in our mind. In other words, all the volatile liquids they have more vapor pressure, and all the non-volatile liquids they have less vapor pressure. So if you go for strong intermolecular forces, because they have less vapor pressure, all the molecules which have less vapor pressure are polar covalent. The best example which can show less vapor pressure is water. To some extent, you can take even water is the only example which is having less volatile nature. Greater volatile, weaker intermolecular forces means you can take ethyl alcohol, you can take chloroform, you can take carbon disulfide, you can take benzene. All these are the examples which are highly volatile liquids. In fact, all the organic solvents, they are highly volatile, and all the polar solvents, they are non-volatile, is what the generalization which you have to keep it in your mind in deciding the vapor pressure and its factors. So the next part of the discussion here is, that is, vapor pressure of liquid to liquid solutions. Indirectly, we are studying something about the Rolle's law. So here you take, according to the Rolle's law, what we are doing here is, we are trying to take, that is, a container is filled with solvent molecules. These are the solvent molecules, and imagine that these bigger sphere molecules, these are the solvent molecules which are in the bulk of the liquid. These are all the solvent molecules. Right now you are finding that these are the pure solvent molecules. Let the vapor pressure, it is a closed system, so let the vapor pressure of the pure solvent molecules be given by P naught. Now we are trying to take some more molecules. Imagine that, and this is the surface area available at the, this is the surface area available at the top, and now what we are doing is, we are trying to introduce some amount of solute molecules. They may be, because we are speaking about the Rolle's law, let us take some non-volatile solutes. This is a pure solvent. Maybe it's a volatile or non-volatile, but the solute molecules which we are trying to add into the pure solvent is compulsory, should be a non-volatile solute. So imagine that you are adding some quantitative solute molecules which are having smaller spheres like this. These are all solute molecules which are non-volatile solutes. These are non-volatile solute particles. Particles or molecules. So what is happening here is, these non-volatile solute particles or molecules, they go and they distribute evenly, and they just try to occupy the spheres which are larger. That means now this has become a binary solution, because there are two components. One is, it has solvent molecules are there in that solution, and also solute molecules are there. Now there are two components. The smaller spheres are the solute molecules. But mind you, the moment you are adding solute molecules to the solvent molecules, now this has become a solution. When you are adding solute molecules to the pure solvent molecules, now the solution has become, now the component has become, now it has become a binary solution. And now the vapor pressure is PS. Now by adding non-volatile solute particles to the given pure solvent molecules, you are trying to decrease the, these are trying to decrease the surface area. and also they are trying to decrease the overall vapor pressure. Vapor pressure, there is a decrease in the vapor pressure of overall binary solution. So that means from this observation, it's very clear that the vapor pressure of the pure solvent is always greater than the vapor pressure of the solution. PS is the vapor pressure of solution and P naught is the vapor pressure of the pure solvent. This also means that the vapor pressure of the solvent minus vapor pressure of the pure solvent solution, the difference of the vapor pressure of pure solvent and the vapor pressure of solution, this difference is going to give you LVP. This LVP we call it as lowering of vapor pressure. Lowering of vapor pressure. Now take this lowering of vapor pressure P naught minus PS. Again, you divide it with P naught. When you are dividing it with P naught, we are calling this as RLVP, which we call it as relative lowering of vapor pressure. But because you are adding non-volatile solute particles or solute molecules into the pure solvent molecules, this RLVP P naught minus PS divided by P naught must become equal to, because you are adding a solute molecules, non-volatile solute molecules, this must be equated with the XA. This XA represents the mole fraction of solute. XA represents the mole fraction of solute. So here XA is the mole fraction. XA is the mole fraction of solute. That means now if you want to define the Rolle's law, this expression is going to give us the Rolle's law. This is the Rolle's law. This expression is going to give us the Rolle's law. Now from the Rolle's law, what we are able to understand is the relative lowering of when a non-volatile solute is added to a given solvent, the relative lowering of vapor pressure of the solution, the relative lowering of vapor pressure of the solution is always equal to the mole fraction of its solute. This is the Rolle's law expression, and this Rolle's law is applicable, this Rolle's law is applicable only for dilute solutions. It is applicable only if the solute is solute and solvent, neither they are associated nor they are dissociated. That means it is not applicable. Rolle's law is not applicable for the solutions in which the solute and the solvent molecules, that is associates or dissociates, solutions in which the solute and the solvent molecules are, if they associates or if they dissociate, it is not going to be applicable. These are the two setbacks of Rolle's law, but however this is the expression. And when you go for the mole fraction of solute, we can again expand this mole fraction of solute, giving the one more expanded formula. If it is mole fraction of solute, we can take Na divided by Na plus Nb, where we can take Na means here number of moles of solute, Na represents the number of moles of solute, and Nb represents the number of moles of solvent. The sum of the number of moles of solute and solvent together gives us the total sum of the number of moles of solution present in the container. So therefore, again, you can take the number of moles of solute as weight of the solute divided by molecular weight of the solute, and number of moles of solvent, we can take weight of the solvent divided by molecular weight of the solvent. Depending upon the composition and the relative amount of solute and solvent, sometimes we can ignore the number of moles of solute in the denominator. In other words, if the solution is very dilute, then we can take number of moles of solute is very, very less compared to number of moles of solvent. Under such case, you can take the expression P naught minus PS divided by P naught is equal to Na divided by Nb. That means we are just taking the number of moles of solute divided by number of moles of solvent. If the solution is going to become very, very dilute, such that in the denominator we can ignore the number of moles of solute and taking into consideration only the number of moles of solvent.